When we talk about colonial empires, our minds instantly jump to Great Britain, Spain, Portugal, France, or the Netherlands. Most times we don't really talk about the German colonial empire because, spoiler alert, it didn't last very long. There's not much to the history of its demise. Germany lost World War I, and because of the peace treaty that followed, Germany lost every single one of its overseas colonies, being reduced to its European dimension, which even itself was smaller than before. But for a decent amount of time, Germany was an important player in the European powers' scramble for Africa. They also stretched their rule to the East Indies and the Indian and Pacific Oceans, as well as the shores of China. There was even an attempt to colonize a region of South America, known as Little Venice, which I'll get to in a minute, not to mention the various plans that the Germans had to expand their empire. So in this video, I'm going to briefly go over the history of the German colonial empire. The German Empire unified in 1871 under Chancellor Otto von Bismarck, and it is the colonies of the German Empire itself which we'll mainly be focusing on in this video. But before we get to those, I want to mention a few others that existed as well. These were short-lived attempts of colonization by individual German states which had occurred in preceding centuries before the unification. And there were essentially four main pre-unification German colonies. The first was Little Venice, then the Hanau Indies, Bavaria's colonies, and Brandenburgian slash Prussian colonies. Little Venice was actually the first German colonial project. However, it was a private business initiative. Emperor Charles V ruled German territories as well as the Spanish Empire, and he was deeply in debt to the Welser family of Augsburg. Instead of repaying them in money, the Welsers accepted a grant of land on the coast of present-day Venezuela in 1528, which they called Little Venice. I have no idea why. A small number of German settlers were sent to the colony, but most of them died. Something else that didn't help is that, apparently, the governors devoted most of their time and expeditions into the interior to search for El Dorado, the mythical golden city. In 1556, the Spanish crown revoked the Welser's privilege and resumed control of the territory. The Welsers were treated as heroes in much of the 19th century German fiction and regarded as an inspiration for German colonial projects later on in history. Then the Hanau Indies, which consisted of a lease contract between the Dutch East Indies and the county of Hanau in the Dutch Guianas, also in South America, and this happened in 1669. However, Hanau didn't have enough resources or people to make the colonization of this region successful. A similar situation happened with the Duchy of Gelderland, a German-led state which leased part of Tobago, eventually failing as well. Bavaria's efforts at colonizing weren't very good either. A Bavarian ruler, Ferdinand Maria, was interested in a project to colonize New Amsterdam, currently New York, but after the Netherlands ceded the territory to Britain, the idea was abandoned in 1675. The most significant pre-unification example of German colonialism lies with Brandenburg and Prussia, who in fact took the lead when it came to unifying the German states in Europe. In 1646, Frederick William, the Duke of Prussia, attempted to persuade the Holy Roman Emperor to create a new East India Company to aid in German states' plans of colonization, but the emperor refused, not wanting to disturb the interest of other European powers. In 1651, they made another effort, agreeing to purchase Danish possessions in India, but they never raised enough money to do so. Finally, they were able to make some advances and began trading people and resources in Africa through the Brandenburger African Company. After establishing the colony of the Brandenburger Gold Coast from 1682 to 1721. In modern-day Ghana, which flew this really cool white flag with a black eagle, eventually being renamed to Prussian Gold coast, but after a while this was annexed by the Dutch. They also leased a port from the Danish in the Caribbean to be able to trade there in the island of St. Thomas. But from there onwards, their attempts of expansion were unsuccessful, as they just couldn't find any other islands to rule over. They tried buying some in the Caribbean, sharing others, but all of the deals fell through for various reasons. The French also began attacking the Brandenburg African Company, and because of that, it became insolvent in 1735. Also, the heir of Frederick William, King Frederick William I of Prussia, didn't really care for colonization and wanted to focus his resources on the Prussian army instead. And so, Prussian and German early efforts of colonizations were put to an end. But like I mentioned, as Germany began to unite, first under the German Confederation, and then as a rebranded and more centralized German Empire, the efforts of colonization returned. It made sense. Their ambitions of European expansion had been essentially fulfilled, so now they needed to establish their role as a main European power by doing what neighboring nations were doing as well, venturing out into the seas and establishing colonies whose resources could be used to become richer and stronger. The German Confederation had a really odd colony, because it wasn't in Africa or America, it was in Ukraine. A group of settlers founded the estate of Askania Nova in present-day Ukraine as a colony leased to a German count, but after it went bankrupt, they sold it to a Russian noble. Now, let's get back to the actual overseas colonies. It's interesting because the first big movement of Germans to a colony happened before they had any of their own, and to a destination that did not belong to them. In 1808, King João VI of Portugal encouraged European settlers to move to Brazil, especially to the south, and the same continued even after Brazil's independence, aiming to attract European migrants. Around 6,000 Germans therefore moved to Rio Grande do Sul, an area which even today has significant German heritage. A similar situation happened in Chile, to where many Germans also migrated. Another example was the migration to Pennsylvania in the 1600s, when Germantown was founded, as many Germans fled from the 30 Years' War in Europe. 65,000 Germans landed in Philadelphia alone up to 1775. More than 950,000 Germans immigrated to the US in general in the 1850s and 1.4 in the 1880s. But this early form of colonization by the German Confederation consisted only of private migration by German settlers, the establishment of small settlements that were not under state control of Germany, and the creation of trade companies, which as a general rule weren't very successful, but some were, and laid the groundwork for future actual German colonies, like trade outposts in Africa, Samoa, and New Guinea. This was around 1860 and was in part conducted by the Hanseatic Republics of Hamburg and Bremen. These were known as Privatkolonisatoren, independent colonizers. It seemed that up to this point, there wasn't really a desire to territorially expand and permanently settle these places as direct German possessions by the German state itself, in part because of their internal priorities. Another possible reason for this was that German colonial policy was more focused on commerce rather than missionary activities of converting indigenous people to Christianism, like we saw with Portugal or Spain, but also because they didn't want to aggravate Britain, since they knew their royal fleet was tremendously powerful. In fact, some say a defining factor for the actual beginning of German colonization was the establishment and construction of the German Imperial Fleet, which began as early as 1867, allowing them to enforce their colonial aspirations. But it all changed in 1871. With German unification. Now that it was united, Germany was stronger with a common foreign policy and had a fleet to call its own, but they still needed to play catch-up against the rest of Europe and find their own place in the sun. Many Germans also saw the acquisition of colonies as the true confirmation of being a single nation, and therefore saw overseas expansion as a requirement for the success of the unification of Germany under one flag. And so, the German colonial empire got its official start in around 1884, bearing this flag, the German Imperial Tricolor, black, white, and red horizontal stripes, but in the center, a white circle, filled with the German coat of arms, the Imperial Eagle, acquiring a number of territories in Africa, mostly places in which private colonizers had previously gotten leases to establish settlements and trade, or had just arrived and did so in agreement with the locals. But the way Germany officialized its direct state rule over the lands was through the partition of Africa, in which, through the 1884 Conference of Berlin, known as the Scramble for Africa, European powers divided the African continent among themselves. The results were the ones we see on this map. Most of Africa went to the British and the French, some to Belgium, Portugal and Italy, and a tiny bit to Spain. And Germany was also granted a significant portion of the land. German East Africa, present-day Burundi, Rwanda, and Tanzania, Germany Southwest Africa, present-day Namibia, German Cameroon, which is today Cameroon, Gabon, Congo, the Central African Republic, and Togoland, which is present-day Togo and parts of Ghana. The territory of Cameroon was expanded in 1911 when France ceded part of the French Congo to them to solve the Agadir crisis, in which France and Germany were rivaling over the control of Morocco. This almost doubled the German colony size from 465,000 square kilometers to 760,000. Although many in Germany said it was empty territory without much potential, and the German colonial secretary eventually resigned over the issue. A fun fact is that Bismarck despised colonization and thought it was in part a waste of time. At one point, he apparently stated Southwest Africa was such a burden that he wanted to give it away to the British. The fact is, the Germans did face a lot of issues in Africa, one of which being several rebellions from the local native populations against their rule, leading to a pushback by the Germans and terrible consequences through evil actions to the indigenous people. The Germans also became more active in the Pacific, annexing a few islands that would be called German New Guinea, part of present-day New Guinea, and several nearby island groups. However, some were directly bought from other nations. The Caroline Islands, Palau, Mariana, and the Marshall Islands were bought off Spain, and also leasing a few coastal territories in China, like Kiachu Bay in Tsingtao. A fun fact is that the second biggest Chinese beer today, Tsingtao beer, was founded by German settlers in 1903, and so they began establishing real colonies in these areas. However, even being somewhat converted to colonialism by 1884, Otto von Bismarck still preferred a model of chartered companies exploring and managing the colonies, rather than establishing full-on colonial governments, which would be more expensive. Examples of this were the German New Guinea Company, bearing this lion flag, but it transitioned to an imperial governor ruling system in 1899. The German East Africa Company was another example, and this one lasted until 1920, bearing an interesting flag as well, a stylized representation of the constellation of the Southern Cross. Each of the actual German colonies themselves merely flew the imperial standard. However, they did have specific coats of arms, and we currently have proposed flags for each of them, which take the imperial tricolor and add the local shield to the center, replacing the national one, leaving us with some really cool flags as we can see here. But it is doubtful if these were ever actually used at the time. And at the expense of local indigenous people and natural resources, the German colonies were growing and thriving. At its peak, they ruled over 2.6 million square kilometers, excluding Imperial Germany in Europe, with around 12.5 million inhabitants. But the number of native Germans in these places was extremely small. The German colonial population consisted of only 19,696 Germans in Africa and the Pacific colonies in 1913. The other millions were indigenous people. The Germans made considerable profits, and they built impressive settlements with schools and hospitals. They were building these things to last. In today's Kpalime city in Togo, water is still led into the city from nearby waterfalls through the pipe system installed by the Germans before World War I. The thing is, maybe these things did last, but not to serve the Germans, because by 1914, World War I began, and Britain and its allies took a strong position against German colonies immediately, with battles taking place there as they did in Europe, although perhaps not in the same dimension or intensity. In the Pacific, Britain's ally Japan declared war on Germany and quickly seized several of Germany's island colonies, the Mariana, Caroline, and Marshall Islands, with virtually no resistance. However, the Germans did resist quite well in Africa, especially in the east. German General Paul von Lettow-Vorbeck led their forces, which were greatly outnumbered by the British, and was able to achieve important victories in the area, a style of guerrilla warfare which forced the British to dedicate a lot of manpower and resources to a reasonably small theater in the war. And this was the strategy: put up such a resistance that they would be forced to move some forces from the Western European front, thus making the main theater of war more favorable to the Central Powers. Eventually, they were pushed back and retreated into Portuguese Mozambique and North Rhodesia, but still resisting. In fact, it is said Lettow-Vorbeck was the last German general to surrender to the Entente, only receiving word of the armistice 3 days after it happened in Europe and remaining somewhat undefeated. After the war ended in 1918, Germany's overseas empire was dismantled. The Treaty of Versailles in Article 22 defined that German colonies were transformed into League of Nations mandates and divided between Belgium, the United Kingdom, France, and Japan, with the determination not to see any of them returned to Germany. In Africa, the United Kingdom and France divided German Cameroon and Togoland, Belgium gained Rwanda, Urundi, the United Kingdom obtained by far the greatest landmass of German East Africa, thus gaining the missing link in the chain of British possessions stretching from South Africa to Egypt, and Portugal received the Kionga Triangle, a sliver of German East Africa. In the Pacific, Japan gained Germany's islands north of the equator and Kiachu in China. German Samoa was assigned to New Zealand, German New Guinea, the Bismarck Archipelago, and Nauru went to Australia as mandates, indirectly under the control of the British as well. After that, calls for recovering the empire were few and unsuccessful. There was a brief claim of part of Antarctica in 1939, New Swabia, but it never came to be. A limited empire, which took a long time to get started, was reasonably successful, but however, did not last very long. The plans they had of expanding their colonies to Somalia, the Congo, Mozambique, and other parts of Africa were instead replaced by the complete loss of their territories overseas. And Germany was once again confined to its continental limits of Europe, an anticipation of the fate of its neighboring European powers, who saw the collapse of their own colonial empires a few decades later. So that was a brief overview at the history of the German colonial empire, starting from the very early attempts at German colonies by specific German states, which, like we saw, ended up failing for a number of reasons, but paved the way to the reasonable size German empire in Africa and Asia, which came to an end with the peace treaty that followed the end of World War I. Remember to leave a comment if you'd like me to do this for any other colonial empires, going briefly over their history, how they began, grew, and ultimately ended. Always remembering that as interesting as these historical videos are, and as romanticized as colonial empires may seem to be for Europeans, we must always remember that they were built on the backs of oppressed native populations, and their success is not due to some European superiority, but instead the exploration in an inhumane manner of other innocent people. Thanks so much for watching this video. Subscribe if you want to catch future ones, and I will see you next time for more general knowledge.